Your summary of the season, just your feeling with the ups and the downs and all that stuff.
Yeah, so I think on the one hand, you sort of envision our season as two seasons, when we were healthy and when we weren't. So your initial memory of this, when you think about it, and I know when fans talk to me about it, like, well, you were number one in the West on New Year's Eve. And the things that you talk about that team, where we were second in the league in net rating, and we were tied with Denver for the best record in the West, and we're sixth in clutch rating, and we're sixth in offense and sixth in defense. Well, at that point, Brandon had already missed 20 games, and Z had already missed 8 games. You know, it's not just that those guys missed games. It's that we had so many players out for so long. We had 8 different guys miss 15 games. 6 of the guys we closed games with missed 15 plus games. So it was one of those things from a coaching perspective that they never had their footing underneath them at all. And so I feel really badly that when you look back on the season, the whole season was upheaval. The whole season was chaotic from that standpoint. And at the same time, I would tell you, to win 42 games and to have 13 different players score 20 points in games you win, and 6 different players can score 35 points in games you win, and 4 guys score 40 in games you win, we've got an awful lot of talent. So the core and the nucleus of what we have here is very, very good. We haven't seen it play enough minutes together to be able to say, yes, this is a championship caliber roster. It's a really impressive group of players, and it's a really impressive group of human beings. And so from my perspective, you know, you spend the day yesterday sort of decompressing a little bit. If I'm a fan of this team, I'm really disappointed and I'm angry, and I feel like a lot was left undone. I feel the same way. And yet at the same time, we've got something that very, very few teams have when you look at our ability to move forward and grow from here. We have a chance to be special good. And what's going to get us to that point is we have to learn from these moments, the things that we didn't do well enough. You know, our Suns teams, our 7 seconds or less teams, we went to the conference finals, I think, 3 times in 6 years. And those teams, I think, averaged some ridiculous number of wins. It doesn't matter what the number is. Say it's 50. It doesn't matter. When you win that many games, you don't tend to really examine the root cause of why you're not winning the games you most care about. What's the real reason we can't beat San Antonio? Well, nobody, when you're winning 61 games, is going to walk into your coach's office and say, well, here's what you're doing wrong. Well, when you win 42 games and you lose to Oklahoma City in a play-in game, we can have those conversations. And that's going to pay dividends for us moving forward in a way that, if you've done this for a while and you've embraced the idea of getting better and you realize you make mistakes every day, we can make that mean something really meaningful when we're trying to win the most meaningful games we want to win. So if I'm a fan and David Griffin comes back up here next year and says, yeah, you know, we just got to get better, I'm going to be pissed off. We've got to get better right now. We've got to learn from everything that we didn't do properly and make that mean something. But I will tell you, I'm also really, really grateful we didn't trick this up, find a way to win 50 games, win one round of the playoffs, and convince ourselves we're better than we are. We didn't set false expectations for ourselves. We are not good enough right now, and we know it. And at the same time, 27 teams in this league would trade their roster for ours and our draft picks for theirs. We got a lot to look forward to, but we have a hell of a lot of work to do. So I'm super excited about it, to be honest with you. Like, I get kind of almost chills thinking about it, because I know we've got enough of the right people here to make the right decisions. So.
And when you look back at how much your 4 years here have been, you know, affected by injuries, how much do you look at that and say, maybe we need to change something, maybe we got to try something different, I guess, because it's not just this 1 year, right?
Yeah, I mean, and it's a lot of things that go into that. You know, it's a lot of it is luck. I think Larry was the one who came up here and said, you know, you don't plan for stepping on someone's foot. But what happened this year, and this was a very real thing, and we talked about it as it was happening. When you miss that many guys for as long as we did, we ran the wheels off of the bench guys. it's not an accident that we're not still playing and Jose and Larry Nance ended the season injured. Those are the guys who are your heart and soul bench guys. Those are the guys your coaches count on. Your rotations are a mess all year because they're just struggling to find something they can trust that they can believe in. So it's when those guys have the wheels run off, what would you believe in? So I understand from a coaching perspective, we put them in a really bad position. And at the same time, there's things we can do better at every area of this organization. And so what I don't want the narrative to be about our team is, oh my God, they have to fix the medical situation. Well, we got to fix a lot of stuff. We got to do a whole bunch of things better. That's just a part of it. The reason we know it's such a big part of it is because we had such a small margin for error. And when you've got a small margin for error and you start by missing that many dudes, well, you're not going to be very good. But if we didn't have a small margin for error to start with, you guys wouldn't be as worried about the medical thing. So the margin for error is the thing we got to get better at all of it. So I really don't like the conversation being player availability. It's also, let's do the right things with the players that are available. Let's get those guys doing the right things every day, and let's build the right culture where we can be critical of each other in ways that we need to be. And I failed miserably in that. So we've got to do a better job in a lot of different areas.
If I can follow up on the availability thing just once, there have been instances, you can't prevent injuries, but there have been instances over these few years where guys have aggravated injuries mm-hmm. during the rehab, mm-hmm. and when guys returned to play, took longer mm-hmm. than the original prognostication. So is this a time for y'all to take a long, hard look at what you're doing with the process you can control, which is diagnosing the problem, preparing mm-hmm. a plan for the guys, and executing that plan so you can get them back as safely and quickly as possible?
So, sure, but no more so than last year was. We try to do a fairly deep dive in those areas all the time. We get input from our players all the time and how they perceive their experiences going in that area. We've done that every year we've been here, and we'll do it again. And we're going to do a really deep dive into a lot of different facets of what we do. But that's certainly one of them, no doubt. I mean, it's not going to be immune from it by any means. But we're going to do the same thing about the way we go through the draft process and the way we do advanced scouting and the way we do college scouting. We'll do the exact same review of everything we do. So, again, I really want to make sure we don't pin this all on one thing.
I know you obviously have already dealt with star LeBron and the aura that person has and the, you know, everything that comes with it. When people talk about Zion and there's national people saying the locker room's against him, the teams are against him, is that a distraction for you? I mean, not that you have to address every rumor or talk about it, but you've dealt with somebody who's been in this situation before. Just kind of your process of dealing with someone who is a kind of a larger than life figure.
It's frustrating for me because I know what it does to a team to have 90% of the questions you're asked revolve around one person. When that person is in the act of carrying you to the finals and being the best player on the planet all the time, that hits different than when a guy is struggling through the things he struggled through. And it's not fair to him, it's not fair to the teammates, right? So I talked to the league about this that almost the day we won the lottery. The expectation was we're going to be on national TV 34 times. Well, he hadn't done anything to earn that yet, right? But that was the expectation placed upon him. That's hard. That's really challenging as a 19-year-old player at the time. And so I think there's been a lot put on him that's not fair. Some of it his own doing, quite frankly. He came up here the other day and told you all, physically, I'm fine. And nobody followed up on what that means. Well, physically, I'm fine means I'm not currently injured. He wasn't physically cleared to play basketball. He was playing one-on-none. He went up and windmill dunked pregame. Well, that's not the skill set that makes you capable of playing skilled 5-on-5 basketball. He was never cleared to play 5-on-5 basketball. So for people to now say, well, he chose not to play basketball, that's nonsense. That's not factual. But that's a way more interesting story than the kid wasn't cleared to play basketball. That's the truth. I mean, I know everybody wants there to be some amazing story behind all of this. There's not that. The kid said I'm fine physically because he's not currently injured. He was never cleared to even play 3-on-3 full court. Like, that's not where he was. So these things get frustrating when you're dealing with them, and nothing that's being said about the kid is particularly factual one direction or another, and I apologize for calling him a kid, but when you're 22 years old and all of this expectation is placed upon you and your teammates have to answer the vast majority of their questions about you, your coach has to answer the vast majority of the questions about you, and we've got guys like Trey Murphy and Herb Jones achieving what they're doing every day, and an all-NBA player, caliber player in Brandon Ingram, dominating the NBA coming down the stretch, it's frustrating that those things get dwarfed in comparison to things that are fabricated about a guy who's doing all he can to play basketball. So it's just an interesting, it's frustrating, and it's totally different than LeBron's situation, because he was in the act of doing it all the time. It's just different.
And to follow up on that, I mean, I think part of the confusion is asked of what can you do on the court? Mm-hmm. And, you know, he suggested I could do everything on the court. And so it helps you just said the thing, but, like, I don't know, why is there, it just seems like there's so much miscommunication all the time. Like, why can't you guys just say the thing more? Like, you just.
Well, it's interesting because I did. I spoke before he did, and I said what was going on and said exactly what was going on. And he makes the one misstatement about physically I'm fine. Well, the reality is, like, what's the thing? So had I been here, I would have clarified it immediately, right? But what's the thing? So the thing is, when you're going through a rehab process and a player does not report, I'm very comfortable and confident in this movement, you don't go to the next movement. That's not because he's choosing not to play basketball. Yeah. That's because a rehab protocol requires that a player is comfortable with the movement you're doing. And I understand your question, and, like, I'm not saying that you should have possibly known that. You couldn't have possibly known that. So the miscommunication is very largely our fault. But I also think there's a component of this where if we don't, and I'm not saying you specifically do this, but if we don't always look for the most sinister outcome, there's usually not one. And that's the thing for me that I'm challenged by with the Z thing.
And what do you think just needs to change just so he's more available moving forward?
It's a great question, and I wish I could immediately pinpoint the answer. I think a big part of it is on him. I think there's a lot he can do better, and he would, I think, tell you that. He certainly owned up to that. And I think we need to do a better job of maybe examining the whole situation top to bottom a little bit better. You know, I've heard people say what you're doing is not working. Okay, well, we're aware of that at the time it happens, right? We're not intentionally not doing the right things. So I think finding a way to put him in the best position to succeed is important. And I think his participation in that is a big part of it as well.
From a team building perspective, Zion will go from the 13 figure to somewhere up above 30. You'll have three guys around there. I mean, how did that just impact things of, you know, having three guys who are making that figure from a team building perspective?
It's a great question. And because the CBA has been changed and parts of it have been leaked out and we don't really know, one of our big challenges this offseason when I talk about the things we're going to have to do differently, we're going to have to learn that. And we've been working under a totally different set of rules, and team building is based almost entirely on the gap you can create between the cap and the tax, and your ability to do things to get better really hinge upon that. So with all of the media accounts that are out there now, you're kind of led to believe that the CBA may help teams in our position, that we may actually be able to keep a core together and not have to choose between one good young player and another. And I hope that's true once we dive into it. But the CBA and our ability to navigate in a sustainable way is everything to team building. It's in a situation like ours, when we're not going to triple up the spending of other teams in the league, it matters a lot.
How much do you just mentioned kind of being in the moment of, you know, an up and down season. Do you need to get away from it before you say, let's talk about these changes or these mm-hmm. new policies and procedures, or do you want to kind of jump into it immediately while it's fresh?
So just even taking one day off before we did this is different than what I experienced growing up in the league. And I think my preference, my very strong preference, is for everybody to take at least a weekend to just decompress a little bit. Because when you've got disappointment all over every conversation, you make worse decisions. And you don't want to own mistakes as quickly right away either. I think the things that you do wrong and the mistakes we make as a franchise, they mean more to you when you're not angry about officiating or whatever it might be that you point to in the heat of the moment. So,
how would you assess the job that Willie did in year two and just, you know, from year one to year two?
I mean, again, I think Willie and his staff, right? He's a second-year coach, and he's got a very young supporting staff as well. I thought they navigated an incredibly difficult situation very, very well. I know our players will talk about the fact that he never changes and that he keeps his calm and in chaos, and that's meaningful. But this was a really difficult situation to navigate. And I don't think I really had enough appreciation for it, honestly, until I got to the end of the season and we did a lot of the examination of exactly what the injury situation was and what they were dealing with from a night in, night out standpoint. These three guys are out, these three guys are available. It would have been excruciating to do that. And I think because of that, it also made 5-on-5 practices much more complicated. What you were getting out of those was much less significant. So I think given an incredibly bad set of circumstances, I thought they did a remarkable job. I mean, we've gone 31, 36, and 42 on wins while player availability's gone down. And we're making mistakes outside of that throughout. And they managed to win more games than we did last year. We didn't win the games we want to win, and I am by no means satisfied, and neither are they. But I think based on what they were dealing with, I think you'd have to say they came through it pretty well.
And last summer you talked about the importance of establishing that consistency with the roster, building chemistry. You brought basically the same team back. This summer, are you expecting more change within the roster? You think that's necessary to take the next step?
Well, last year it was a little easier just because we didn't really have free agents. And again, the CBA hadn't changed. So I think it would be a total guess on my part to talk about that. I know we feel like the bones of this franchise are really sound. And what we do to get to the next level and make this exactly what it needs to be, I can't tell you right now.
How would you characterize the relationship between your front office, the analytics team, and the coaching staff and the communication? I think you look around the league and writers who cover them, if things are going well, you know, people are like, oh, the front office and coaching staff sees eye to eye, but things aren't going well, they might say, oh, the front office is trying to meddle too much or whatnot.
I've heard that before.
Yeah. So where would you say, like, your relationship is and that line of communication? And, you know, I think you mentioned being able to tell each other what y'all need to hear.
Mm-hmm.
How would you characterize it?
So I think if you just disconnect the question of analytics from it at all, I would say we do a really good job of communicating in general. I would tell you that organizationally we're not good enough in the analytics space, and we have a lot of work we have to do in that area. And that's a me thing, that's not a coaching thing. That's not his reliance upon it or his lack of reliance upon it. It's the way we incorporate it top to bottom in a flow-through way that makes sense in terms of our communication, and we've got a lot to do there, which is ironic because it's sort of where I came from. But it's not something that is not why things didn't get done. It was survival with the roster to a huge degree. And so I think there's a lot we're going to get better in that space, and there's an awful lot changing too. Like, what's happened now in the game camera space and all of that, it's going to change radically what we do. The bandwidth we're going to have now to make real meaningful decisions is infinitely greater. So what would be good is if we can be in the forefront of that. And right now I would tell you we haven't been. So.
And you mentioned the medical staff, just to say the thing like CeCe said, what's your level of confidence with what y'all are doing on the medical side, player performance side? Just behind the scenes?
I would tell you that I think we've got incredibly good people doing it and really good human beings. And we've got to do a better job of translating those things to availability. And in some cases, that's on the off-the-court people, and in some cases, that's on the court people. And we've got to do a much better job of finding stasis in that space, for sure.
You
Griffin, can you talk about the two leaders that did play 70-something games, CJ, Giannis, what they brought to you, and with injuries bleeding over these last couple seasons, to get ahead of it, is there any worries about CJ's shoulder holding him out of training camp next year, knowing what that entails?
So quickly, no to next year for CJ. We expect him to be 100%. What CJ did, what Jonas did, being as available as they were and playing through the things they played through, is remarkable. I would tell you Larry played an awful lot the last 3 weeks to month of the season when he probably shouldn't have in many ways. But CJ and Larry wanted to send a message that this is what you do. And what CJ did as a leader in walking the walk, playing with a totally torn thumb ligament, which Zion his own self has done through a year, and playing with a torn labrum on his shooting arm, pretty remarkable, and not wanting it listed on the injury report because he didn't want anybody to take cheap shots at it. Smart, and the kind of veteran leadership you expect from him. It's a huge part of why we wanted to bring him. It's a huge part of why we extended him. And every single thing you hope to get from he and from Larry from a leadership perspective was there. What Brandon did from a leadership perspective was really significant, not just his on-the-court play, which was definitely all NBA level, but his willingness to coach young players and to get involved in their development was really impressive. He's very, very important to the younger players on this team. And the things that he did as a leader were really understated throughout because he's just not somebody who is vocally out there looking like it. He's not looking like an alpha. He's taking care of everybody at a really high level. So CJ certainly did that, and Larry did that. Jonas was definitely the guy who, if somebody was going to tell you you couldn't make the club in the tub, he's that guy. You know, he's going to be in front of you every day and make sure you know, play. We play here. This is what we do. And so I'm super grateful to those guys for that. I think our younger players recognize it and appreciate it as well. So that was meaningful for sure.
I know you said you're still figuring it out because the core hasn't played a ton together yet. And I think you said some of this at like the All-Star break or after the All-Star break at the trade deadline about like pushing your chips in and knowing when to and mm-hmm. not to. How difficult or does that make it this offseason, knowing you just referenced draft picks and young players, you know, as far as being more aggressive or less aggressive this offseason?
I think part of it is, not part of it, I would say far more of it is connected to the CBA and what it really is going to allow us to do. I would say that we don't need to see a whole lot more to know that Zion Williamson is an all-NBA caliber player when he's healthy. What he did in the games he played was truly transcendently special. Brandon can do the same thing, and they're both 25 or younger. That's awesome. You don't need to see a lot more to know that, right? Like, that's good for us. In terms of how you put the right things around that, that's going to have a lot more to do with how much room we have to work with. Have we seen enough to know unequivocally that it worked when we were number one in the West? No. But we've seen enough to know we're close. We're in and around it. We can figure it out. So I think it's tweaks more than it's huge moves, but I also know that we're all open-minded to if something significant has to happen, we have to do it.
You brought up the net ratings earlier, right? Being at the top of the leaderboards and them going into the new year and then, you know, taking a little bit of a slide back. The defense seemed to have held throughout the year. The offense obviously took a step back. Injuries, Zion missing time, that's going to contribute to it. But parsing out, like, what's real and what's not real, how do you manage that? On the defensive side, it seemed like the team did a really good job of limiting opponent three-point percentage, which may be luck, may not be luck. And then offensively, do you believe what you were seeing earlier in the year is more representative of what's to come?
So the irony in this is I didn't even think we were playing particularly well when we were number one in the West. It's not just that we had the talent available. It's that it hadn't played together before. So Zion missed basically the entire season before for Willie. So there was no way for Willie and his staff to really know how to incorporate him properly into what we were doing in the first place. So they were learning that on the fly, and we were still that good. So moving forward, they'll have at least that knowledge to start from. I think in terms of the net rating and all of those things, and the defensive rating being strong towards the end and offensive rating not being, despite the fact that we had all these guys that were capable of scoring, it's because I think by and large the things that a coaching staff got comfortable with and the players that were consistently available were more defensive oriented for the most part. And so I think there was a tendency to trust what you know. And that has nothing to do with the lack of analytics or willingness to listen to it. It's in a world where nothing seems to be available when I want it to be, these guys are always there for me. And so I think it was a trust question to a huge degree. And that's there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. That's what you should expect to have happen. Now you could ask the question from a team building standpoint, if we know we're going to have player availability issues moving forward, would we have a slightly different mix of those pieces? That's what we'll try to figure out.
And we'll talk about improving offensively. How much of that is taken in making more threes?
Oh, I think that's true. I think Willie and his staff have done a good job of talking about that, being comfortable with your work, trusting your work. And I also think a great deal of that comes from playing with more pace, which we did a lot more of coming down the stretch. And that came from being in condition to do it. So I think we have to do a much better job this off season of calibrating everybody to, we're going to play at this speed. You need to have this much conditioning available when you walk in the door, because we weren't capable of playing at the pace we needed to when we didn't have bodies. And when we did have bodies, we didn't play at that pace because we weren't ready to do it yet. And despite all of that, we were really, really good. So that's exciting, whether there's enough sample size or not. That's something that you know means something. So,
David, a lot of people would argue that nobody improved more on your roster than Trey Murphy. What does his growth mean for you guys moving forward? And do you feel like his ceiling is now elevated after seeing what he did this season?
He should certainly expect it to be elevated. His growth and development, particularly offensively, was amazing. But I think you even saw him protecting the rim a little bit as the low man at a much higher level. And his ability to quick twitch off the floor and block shots was impressive. His ability to slide, defend, elevate at the same time improved, which was a very big success of our strength and conditioning group. He got better. So I think all of that comes from he did the work. You know, he and Herb got better by leaps and bounds as the season went along. Well, it's not an accident. They were working their ass off. That tends to go with improvement. And another huge blessing for us is we can go into the summer knowing our guys work. Like we've got a core of players that will grind. Nobody's going to work harder than Brandon, right? So I think it's one of those things for us where we've got the ability to trust from a player development standpoint, they will put the time in. And now we need to put them in the right position to do that throughout more of our roster. But I laughed when you mentioned Trey Murphy, because we talked about it. His growth, it's absurd what he's done. And just happy for him, because he's doing it the right way and he's about the right things.
Do you think if everybody was healthy, do you think that you would have six starters, basically? Because it would be probably hard, difficult conversation to have with Tom Trey. Maybe he's got to come off the bench.
Well, I don't think that's a difficult conversation from Trey's perspective, because he wants to win, right? So Trey's been willing to come off the bench or start and be really good at doing that. And I think when you speak to him and you see the human he is, that's not a problem. That's not going to be a difficult conversation, regardless if we're healthy or not. So I think that's something the coaching staff has in their favor, is that all these guys just want to win. I mean, it'd be a difficult conversation with some people, but it's not an insurmountable conversation with anyone. So,
as far as, maybe this is like more philosophical, but like, you know, players say they talk to the coaches to get better, coaches talk to the front office. When you're somebody who's at the top and you've done it a long time, we're all evolving and growing. Is it conversations that you say that are frank and open with your staff? Are there mentors that you talk to? Things you, like, how do you evolve year to year in this process?
Yeah, I mean, all of it. Like, for one thing, I don't think I'm at the top, right? I won a championship because LeBron James was from Ohio. I mean, like, let's not each other. Like, I'm here because the guy's from Akron, Ohio. And he's the greatest winning machine probably ever put in front of an NBA game. So from that standpoint, a lot of what makes you good at this is recognizing what you're not good at. And we have that, I think, as a staff. What we didn't have enough of, and I talked about it on a broadcast during the game, was just being comfortable enough with each other to hold each other accountable. Say, are you sure that's really it? Do you really believe that? And that's on me. You know, we have to create that environment. So I would say that internally, I probably haven't created enough of an environment that's like a critical feedback loop. Externally, there are several people that I would talk to and look at as mentors and people that I trust. And I've been really blessed to work with some people that are really good at this, and many of whom are much better than I am. One of them, Kobe Altman, is still playing. So there's a lot of people that are important to me outside of here that we talk to, and some of them are on our staff. Gar Foreman and Todd Quinter are guys that work in the pro space and in the college space, and they've done this for a long time. Gar was really, really good as a general manager in this league, and to have him be available as a resource is a big deal. Mike D'Antoni's a resource on the coaching side, and we use him pretty liberally as well. So yes is the answer to all of it. It's internal and external.
Hey, Griff, you mentioned earlier that you knew the fans were disappointed how this season went. What would kind of just be your message to the fans?
It's challenging for me this close to when it ended because I'm still a little too angry. The message would just be we're moving in the right direction. We may not be moving there as quickly as you would like it to happen, but as long as we grow from what we learned, nothing's fatal. This only gets bad if you try to go too far, too fast, and put yourself in a position you can't get out of financially. We're really, really well positioned to be sustainable into the future with an incredibly talented core of young players that care about one another, and they care about winning in this city. They want to be here and they want to win here. And so I don't think anybody's commitment to the vision or the goal of what we're trying to do in this city and in this state is ever been stronger from anybody. We just have to learn from what we were exposed to, and I know we will. We have the human beings that will do that. So I've been a lot of places where I didn't necessarily feel like we were willing to tackle what laid in front of us, and this isn't that group. We're willing to do what needs to be done, and every player on this team is. So I would feel awfully good buying stock in the team. It's funny how many different people do what I do and what we do from a front office perspective that will put this a lot of different ways. But when I said there's 27 teams that would trade places with me, that's not an accident. They would. We're in a very strong position. We need to get much better at translating that gift into winning the games we most want to win, and we'll do that.
Is properly utilizing load management a difficult challenge?
So I really have gotten to the point where I sort of rankle when I hear load management, because it started out as load management because Coach Popovich wrote on a box score one time old for his three best players, and everybody said that became load management. Well, if you had those three players and you'd won five titles and you're Coach Popovich and you're in the Hall of Fame, you can write whatever you want on the box score. Most of the time, that's not how these decisions are arrived at. I do think there's a disconnect between the NBA and the broadcasting arm and teams that doesn't need to exist. There doesn't need to be that gap there. We could probably help each other on the front end. If you gave me our draft schedule, I could tell you when it's pretty likely guys aren't going to be playing. Not because we choose for them not to play, but playing four games in 5 nights or 3 and 4 is really hard in the NBA. Don't put somebody on national TV when they're playing the fourth, right? Golden State rested every person on their team twice here in our building. Well, if you'd have showed me their schedule, I'd have told you that was gonna happen. And it's not because they're choosing to load manage guys. It's because their best players are 30 plus years old and they can't play three games in 4 days. So I think load management is blamed for things that it's not necessarily responsible for. I will tell you it is very, very difficult to maintain a team through 82 games, play at the pace the game is played at a level of talent that the league has never had before. Leaps and bounds the most talented league that's ever existed. We probably should have had expansion 5 years ago to spread that talent out. So your margin for error in the Western Conference is minuscule to start with. If everything goes right, it's the most competitive our league has ever been. So when you're going to miss a game, you better pick the right one. And if you're not picking them, you better figure out how to keep them available. And that's all we have to do a better. I mean, we just have to do a better job in all of that. So.
Thank you, Griff.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.